Hello and welcome to a beautiful week, and we are blessed to see this week. Of course we are. Well, today we're looking at the Supreme Court versus Electoral Commission. Now, I know I said that this is a subject that will come back for us to discuss, but if I tell you I'm not blown away, I'll be lying to you. I cannot see how for one case, probably one directive, Supreme Court has said it. Indeed, Abu Ramadan went to court. For those of you who don't know Genesis, just quickly bring it. Abu Ramadan went to court and, you know, asked the court that, listen, there are people who are getting on the voters register with their NHIA card. However, with the NHIA card, you could be from Mali, Egypt, you know, Timbuktu, and it doesn't matter. Once you've secured this card, you can then come and register and put your name on it. And therefore, it's not fair, because you then are not able to determine who's Ghanaian and who's not. So Supreme Court apparently said, well, that should stop. So it stopped. Then he went back to court and said, well, you know, lots of people have already registered and they are on the list. And therefore, why don't you ask them to redo the list so that those who came on with this practice, i.e. the NHIA card, take them off. For the layman, we thought the Supreme Court said, yeah, you're right, take them off. However, the legal luminaries are split in two. Those who categorically say, no, that's not what the court says. And those who say, yes, that's what the court says. To you and I, it's just English. So we read English and think, well, maybe the court implied this. I don't know. I have two lawyers in house. And when I finish, by the end of the day, I'm sure we'll get a clear understanding. Well, my name is Anansakwa IV, Kwamuedu Masahine, and also your host. When I come back, we're just going to find out the Supreme Court versus Electoral Commission. No more. Thank you very much for staying. It's one of those shows that's going to be very educative, indeed. Anytime I say educative, then you know that me, your host, I'm so confused about the whole matter. Because, you know, it comes to you in black and white and they tell you, no, it's actually pink and green. Forget about the colors in front of you. So this case has been to the Supreme Court. And when they say Supreme, basically they are the gods of Ghana. You know, they are gods here, are human gods here. So when they speak, that's it. Let there be light, and there will be light. Let there be elections, there will be elections. And let there not be elections, there will not be elections. But what are they saying with regards to individuals who got onto the electoral roll using an identification method, which was their NHIA card? Should they come off and come back on in it with a different ID? Should they just stay on? And then we pass a law to say, well, once you're on, stay on, but henceforth we do something different. I don't know. With me in the studio is lawyer Yao Opong, who's a legal practitioner and also a lecturer at Central University. And for the first time on Sunday, I met Otabel. Yeah, I didn't realize he was that tall. Yeah, he's a tall gentleman. I didn't realize he was so tall. I never met him before. I've seen him, heard him speak, but not in person. Joining us later will be Ibrahim Amaliba, who's also a private legal practitioner. He sent a message to say he's coming, so I hope he gets here soon enough so he can also help us with this discussion. But in any way, the show will go on. But I think we need to make a little, brief comment on, you know, swearing of an oath before you become, a polling agent? I'm a bit confused about it. I mean, has it always been a practice or is this a new practice coming?
Oh, well, good evening. I think oath taking before assumption of any public office is a matter that is part of our public service system. And judges, for the president, cannot commence the performance of his functions unless he takes the appropriate oath. The Chief Justice, parliamentarians, justices, and any other person whose position has been created by statute and is required to take an oath before commencing the functions, performance of the functions. So it is just normal with such situations. And I think without it, mostly you may not be able to perform those functions as expected by law. And so, but over time, some people have even doubted the importance of oath. Mm-hmm. And so it took even one judge, well-known judge, Justice Archer, and made some profound statement in one case called Attorney General versus O2, and then also Capone, that in these modern days, we do not take our oath seriously because the Creator never smites us to death whenever we tell a lie. But he went on to say that whilst he was on the bench, he actually experienced two Protestant ministers of religion who swore, took the oath on the Bible, and yet lied before him as a judge. And so it is not so much about the oath and what people believe can happen to them if they lie after saying or swearing on the oath. But for me, the whole thing boils down to conscience. I mean, you cannot, it would be strange to even expect that you wake up in the morning, there's election in the UK, and political parties have their polling agents standing by the ballot boxes. Police officers, other security personnel are vigorously monitoring elections in such a way as to ensure that no one commits election offenses, including snatching of ballot boxes, or that after declaration of election, people will say that it was rigged. I mean, the recent EU election, as sensitive as it is, I think if anybody had said that the election was rigged, everybody would be surprised. Because the point is, no one will even dream of going to commit election-related offense. So he can just wake up, there's a ballot box thrown through his letterbox. He takes the first seat and take it to the police, the post office, or even online, in space. Who is going to the space to monitor? So the bottom line is conscience. Mm. It appears that no one trusts the other. State institutions that are supposed to also ensure that we enforce the laws, election-related laws, sometimes because of the color they have put on these offenses. Oh, it's just an election-related offense, so let's leave it. So people who want to commit an offense just put on the colors of a political party, burn political party property, burn state property, lock out state officials, lock up state property, and nobody just brings them to the law. Right. And they just go away with the offense they have committed and the property, state property that they have destroyed. And until we see any crime as crime, no matter what color envelopes it, then we will have these problems. And no oath, God himself may have final mercy on us after all he's given us and be gracious to come and administer the oath himself. He may send his angels. But if we, the rest of us, don't change our conscience and our attitude, that no useful purpose will be served by committing election-related offenses, rigging, and so on, all this will come to naught. We will still come back tomorrow. And I'm rather surprised that instead of ensuring that whatever fundamental or problem that is a fundamental reason why we do these things, if you are not able to minimize or eradicate it, it is just going to be worse. And no amount of step, especially oath-taking, even that one may even embolden people, because he knows his, the other colleague, having seen him take the oath, thinks that then he may not be able to commit the offense, but rather that is what is going to embolden him to commit the offense. Because there's an incentive to commit election-related offense. You will not be punished according to law, and you may even be rewarded if you are able to get the particular person in whose favor you commit the offense into power. And it's going to continue. And for me, I think that the Electoral Commission should just rather find other means. First of all, they may, by their conduct, or they should, by their conduct, rather endear themselves to people, for people to, the confidence people have in them to be enhanced, to the extent that they know that if he casts his vote and goes home to sleep, tomorrow, if the number that his the person he supports got is 11, he's not going to become 111, or that if it's 24, it's not going to become 24 plus zero, and things like that. Without that, they should forget about
the oath,
whatever,
swearing.
The oath swearing.
Swear any amount of oath.
People will not be afraid because they know God or the deity on which they swore is not going to smite them.
This oath swearing, I say it's always either, you know, Akunedi or Antwa, if you want the proper oath to be sworn.
Instant justice.
With eggs and schnapps. And I'll tell you what, the correction rate would increase. Anytime you say that, you know, you are ridiculed and everything, but I bet you any money that if you put anybody through those sort of oracles to take an oath, the chances of them abiding by it would increase, whether we like it or not. But it's the truth, and we don't like the truth.
Or maybe so, chemical interrogation.
You see now? But, lawyer, I called you here again because well, we heard that the Supreme Court has, you know, schooled the EC. They even said, you know, there were certain times that they, you know, the posture of the judges were quite harsh or quite stern, you know, emphasizing that, listen, we're coming close to an election. You know, you guys are playing with fire. You could set the whole country ablaze. We, the judges, will be at fault. This morning, there's another long, you know, essay from renowned, you know, Dr. Atuguba, also saying that, listen, he knows exactly what the Supreme Court said. And indeed, he lists the things which the Supreme Court says, and they are, you know, directly opposite to what we all think, that, you know, the petitioners never won the case. People were not allowed to, they haven't been told to take the names off. The EC is independent. You know, so it just leaves the layman very confused as to, you know, so which is which. And he states, if I could find it, stating that, you know, he's going to tell us exactly what the Supreme Court says and what the Supreme Court meant. You know, and, you know, it's coming from no other than, you know, Dr. Atuguba, who's not a small fry. So, you know, somebody like me would then sit back and wonder, oh, maybe I didn't understand, I didn't get the English right. So just have a conversation in layman terms as to, you know, what is what? Help us out.
Thank you very much. I have read something like that. I'm not in the position to confirm that he's the actual author, but I haven't, also from monitoring the system, I haven't also heard him or seen him disclaim or say that it is not his deed. So maybe we, since his name, his title are stated on it, for now, for avoidance of that, perhaps one may, though be cautious, but one may also express one's own thought on these matters. I think the first thing...
It could be that it's not him.
Well, it could be, but yes. I'm saying that, well, it could be, and it could also be that it's him, until perhaps he disclaims, and state that it is not him. Because the matters that are expressed in it are very grave, very serious matters. Some may even bother on prejudicing the outcome of the very, especially the area where the person states that he knows that the people who use the dead people on the register and other people they call undesirables are more than those who use the NHIS card. So it doesn't mean the person really knows the number of those who use the NHI card to register. And that would be interesting. But these are other matters that are yet to be determined by the Supreme Court. And for that matter, I think we will just be cautious. But I think that enough said about that. Mm. But I think one point we need to stress is that, and I always say that if ever God gave us any gift, and he has given us so many resources that sometimes I think he has pampered us too much to the bone. The point is, if we didn't have bold, fearless judges, independent-minded judges, I think that the day we lose such people, this nation will come to an end.
You've always said that.
Yes, and if you don't insist on that, and the court itself, they'll say that sometimes they believe that, and if you read the Tommy Thompson case, Mensah Bonsu, that they said that sometimes the judges feel that lawyers don't criticize their decisions enough. But that they also mean applying decorous language to criticize their work or critique what they do. So it's not that they are shy of criticism, but it's the language you use. Because the moment we let it sound that they are timorosos, and that we say things that will erode the public confidence in them, the alternative will be anarchy, which we don't want. And so as much as possible, yes, we may. And some, when you hear of some of the language others have used against them, some even calling them surrogate electoral commissioners and things like that, I think it's so unfair. And as the court said in that case, that judges are deemed to be strong, but they are the weakest because they don't have the opportunity to respond to what people say on air. And they receive all the punches. They are not able to throw back. And that's why we have to be a bit careful when we are at least critiquing what they say, which is what we should do in a very measured way by applying the appropriate language, which I think that any mature person knows language that is decorous and that which is not. Now, so when you look at the last decision that the Supreme Court gave, for me, it is not a clarification. It is just a repetition of what they have said in 2014, the first Abu Ramadan case, what they have said in May, I think, and then just to repeat it. And so it doesn't lead to any form of interpretation, in my view. Fortunately, they chose the clearest of language, simplest of it. Let's not forget that judges, lawyers even admit that. Some say even substantial part of the law is common sense. I don't believe so. I think common sense plays a role. So normally it is not by the application of sophisticated language that you carry out or you're able to interpret a decision of the court. And in fact, when the decision is clear, it doesn't yield to interpretation. And so sometimes when you let it seem as if your interpretation alone should prevail, and then you go on to as if you are, everybody might just accept what you say, that becomes problematic. I think that all the three decisions, the first one, you remember the first one, the EC, and I will say this with a heavy heart, I think that sometimes our Attorney General's Department, who represent, they are the lawyers of the people, I think sometimes they should play a neutral role. It appears that, especially even this last one, when I read the statement of case they filed, it was just in all force with the EC, the previous one, the same. I think that there are times where the people want to see their lawyers, who are paid with the taxes of their lawyers, that where there is a very sensitive matter like this present one, and mind you, anybody who wants to be neutral can find a neutral ground in a matter like this.
Let me take a quick break here, and then when we come back, we'll continue as to what exactly the instructions are. Are these names supposed to be taken out? Are these names supposed to stay on? Don't move. Well, thank you very much for staying. The Supreme Court versus the EC. Now, let me just read just a sentence out of the very long, long article which supposedly came from Dr. Raymond Atukuba, right? It says, in the rest of this article, I underline each of those holdings and reproduce the portions of the judgment that support those holdings. This will ensure that any doubting Thomases are fully convinced that what I say, the Supreme Court said, is indeed what the Supreme Court said. You know, so somebody like me, this is very instructive. And then it goes on to say, number one, the plaintiff lost their case. The plaintiff lost their case since none of their substantive reliefs were granted. Effectively, the plaintiff sought from the Supreme Court a declaration that the current voter register is unconstitutional, null and void, and no effect because it contains the names of persons not qualified to vote and persons who are deceased. There, they further requested the Supreme Court to set aside the register and order the Electoral Commission to either compile a fresh register or audit the current register of voters through the validation of the registration of each person currently on the register. And then he reads on. Two, the Supreme Court did not declare the register of voters unconstitutional, null and void, and therefore of no effect. Three, the Supreme Court did not order automatic deregistration of persons who register with NHIA cards. Four, the Supreme Court did not order the Electoral Commission to automatically delete the names of all persons on the voter register who registered with the NHIA card as a means of identification. Five, the Supreme Court did not order the Electoral Commission to validate the voters' register. Six, the Supreme Court underlined the constitutional independence of the Electoral Commission.
Yes, I get a problem when I hear people. Of course, I disagree with them when they say that the petitioners, well, the plaintiffs, as the Indabu Ramadan first,
lost the case.
The May one lost the case. I mean, that's not entirely true. And they did not go to court with substantive reliefs. They went to court with four reliefs. So if you decide to separate, color some with the word substantive and others with ancillary, then that is your business or your problem. They went to court with the four reliefs, a declaration that upon true and proper interpretation of Article 45A of the Constitution, the Republic of Ghana, 1992, the mandate of the Electoral Commission to compile the register of voters implies a duty to compile a reasonably accurate and credible register. That was granted. Then two, a declaration that the current register of voters, which contains the names of persons who have not established qualification to be registered, is not reasonably accurate and credible, and therefore consistent with Article 45A. That was also granted. The people went to court with four reliefs. Two were granted, two were not granted. And yet, you say that they have lost the case in entirety because you have decided to color two of them, some of them are substantive, and those you think were rejected were substantive, and those that were granted as if they are just ancillary, then that is your problem. So okay. They did not lose the case. In any case, it is not a matter of whether somebody won or did not win. It is a matter of, as it were, even invoking the very jurisdiction of the court, which has even led to a major decision that came up sometime last week. Without what you call a suit that had been dismissed, you think the Supreme Court would have made such a profound declaration and orders as they have made now? So you can't even take everything away from the two gentlemen. The fact that they have found confidence in the court and have gone there for a declaration, and they have gone on subsequently all because of the respect they have to the court.
Hey, lawyer, listen. So it says, witness the words of the Supreme Court at page 32 and 33. Of the judgment. The result is that we proceed to grant the following reliefs. One, that upon a true and proper interpretation of Article 45A of the Constitution, the mandate of the Electoral Commission to compile the register of voters implies a duty to compile a reasonably accurate and credible register.
That is relief one, which is granted. That is relief one.
Two, a declaration that the current register of voters, which contains the names of persons who have not established qualification to be registered, is not reasonably accurate or credible.
That is relief two, which is granted.
Three, a declaration that the current register of voters, which contains the names of persons who are deceased, is not reasonably accurate or credible. Four.
That was also granted. In fact, three. It was the four which was divided into two.
4A and 4B.
Yes.
The substantive reliefs sought by the...
You see, and that is the point. Why do you collide? These are the reliefs. I have the judgment here. They never describe any relief as substantive. So it's like you give a dog a bad name, so when you kill it, you can justify, but the dog itself is called Ochinamewu. So if it dies, I kill it tomorrow. That is his name anyway. No.
That's a very technical legal example
there. I thought it's more customary.
See now.
Yes. Yeah, so that is what we... Isn't this clear enough? And then they say that delete. And as if the word delete doesn't even sound very clear to us. They said, as is popularly referred to, clean. And the word clean too, we are struggling to understand it. What other simple word could the Supreme Court have applied? And you know, because they also listen, they are in the society, they go to church, attend funerals, they watch football, they have friends. So they know that the most popular word in relation to this is the word clean, the register. If that becomes also ambiguous to us, I cannot even know, Fatom, what other simpler word which can be chosen against the word clean. And so I wasn't surprised that even though the substantive application that was brought last week is still pending, I think they realized that we've got to just make it clear that this has always been what we have meant. And that if it had been complied with since 2014, we wouldn't have been here. That's why I disagree with those who say they gave them a limited time. And now there's also interpretation as to whether we know and we have. There's a difference between, if you read this article, the person is saying that when the Electoral Commission said, did they say we know? Something like that. They didn't mean that they have. If they don't have it, who else must have it? I mean, I came to register with your agent. I left the document with you. If you don't have that document, and you are supposed, your constitutional mandate includes keeping these documents in a safe custody. As a trustee, if you are now asking you to bring it, you are saying that when I said I knew those who registered with NHI, I didn't mean that I have the document in your custody. Not having it in your custody amounts to a breach. And so you said you have it. There must be evidence.
So know by what? Memorizing the... Know in memory or know... How would this know imply?
That's why I think that it is just much ado about nothing. The Electoral Commission themselves have not even just invented any two words to save it. They have said that they are going to produce... One, comply with what the court has ordered them to do. Meaning they will produce what the court has asked them to produce. A list. Why should anybody then try to create ambiguity about a word that they want to comply with, clearly in their mind, know that they understand? They said they are ready. I'm sure by the 29th, that's Wednesday, isn't it? Mm-hmm. They would have filed it or brought it to the attention of the court so that on Friday, that would be Thursday. Then on Friday, and a very significant day, we know what this matters day stands for, where judges that had to die because they were bold and fearless in the face of either overt or actual or constructive threat to them. They still went ahead to did what they had to do against the system, even though they knew the likely consequence of it. And I was very impressed. In fact, I was extremely happy that of all the things that can be done on that day, the first thing I ask is, does the court realize we are going for matters there? And usually the court will not sit. And the person told me that they said they acknowledged that fact and said they will meet in the afternoon. And so it is not a matter that anybody can toy with. For them to fix that day as a day to hear, for me, is one of the most critical decisions that they will have to give, because it goes to the court. This is the mechanism by which somebody is going to be voted with all the enormous powers. Some call it awesome powers of the state vested in him.
Imperial.
Yes. He is going to be in charge of all the gold and diamond that previously your good self and Adan and Anom were the trustees. Now they've taken it all from you. All right? And Article 256 and so on. It is vested in the president. For and on behalf of the people. You vest all this, whether I like it or not, a portion of my tax must be compulsorily taken away from me and managed by the president. And so when a mechanism is going to be applied to choose such a person, I think that we have to apply all the seriousness that God has vested us with and ensure that the right thing is done, so that there will be no doubt in the mind of anybody that there has been some schemes to the disadvantage of one person or the other. And as they rightly said, grant me, I didn't hear some of the things I hear that they won't allow them to maybe cause havoc or havoc to be caused because of their default. But then it is clear that when these matters occur, it knows no bounds. And it's important that those who have the duty to do so now, as always, are making it clear to us that if you don't do the right thing, the consequences are well known.
Let me read this message, because this is also going about, and this is from Berima Kubaji in Jinijini. Berima Kubaji in Jinijini. Says, let me start by congratulating Mrs. Charlotte Osei. It's been exactly a year since she assumed that office, and she has proven her worth and has shown she can't be pushed around. The Supreme Court directs the EC to provide a comprehensive list of people who registered with energized cards. The EC says it can do that, and you have the plaintiff and their MPP appendages claim the EC cannot. It clearly tells how confused the plaintiffs themselves are. What I know is that the Supreme Court can never order an automatic deletion of names. So we wait and watch events as they pan out. It brings about here, and again, the writer, quote and unquote, because he hasn't come to prove or disprove, says the Supreme Court did not order the Electoral Commission to automatically delete names of all persons on the voters register who registered with NHIA card as a means of identification. What's the Supreme Court asking them to do with regards to this?
So when they said you must claim or delete the names and afford them opportunity to be registered if they prove to be Ghanaians and also otherwise qualified to be registered voters in Ghana, who do they think they were referring to? The dead? They should delete the names of the dead people resurrect them and give them opportunity. Or those who registered illegally, minors? No. It could only be deleting the names of these people who use the NHI card.
Kubaji, I'm sure you're still tuned in. So let's get what you understand what lawyer is saying, that if the Supreme Court said delete or clean, which aspect of the people, because at the moment there are four aspects, minors, dead, foreigners, and NHI people who are not supposed to be on there. So there are four categories. And so if the Supreme Court says delete and re-register, which of the categories would they be talking about?
Yeah, for the four, which you appointed at, then those who use the NHI card, even though I still insist that at the time the EC made that CI, it was that portion that you can use NHI card was inconsistent with the Constitution, so it was void. But the court has held that we should not visit the sins of the EC on the innocent person who was asked to apply his NHI card to be registered. So we take it that that was legal. Then the minors, it was illegal, non-citizens or the foreigners you mentioned, illegal. The deceased people, those who are dead, it could be legal, but they cannot resurrect, come back to be given the opportunity. And so the point I make is that I interpret this to be this way. Publish all the names of those who use NHI card to register. Because I believe that before anybody suffers a liability, he must be given fair opportunity to be heard. So you publish their names, probably give them 2 weeks, within which they should go to any of these your offices and justify why their names should not be deleted because they use NHI card. And when the 2 weeks elapse, then you are justified in causing their name to be deleted. And even after that, they still have the opportunity to appear before you or any of your members' offices. But I remember when I made this point in this same room on Newsfile, my own friend, Minister of Hussein, said, no, delete means delete. And then you may then even publish after the deletion and let the people know that we have deleted your name. If you like, you can come back to us and justify why we should restore or register you after you have justified. So even that, those are the two procedures. And either way, the Electoral Commission has the power to delete it because it, in the first place, it doesn't have constitutional mandate to ensure that at least the names of the first three should enter. They made a mistake to make the fourth name, that is the NHI holder, to enter. Now the court has held that. Not that it is unconstitutional now. It was unconstitutional then when they even went to Parliament with the CI, with that particular provision in it. But they wouldn't apply to nullify the votes they used it to cast. Nor would they otherwise also punish them. But since it is your duty, but who says that the Supreme Court doesn't have power to cause that to be done? Since this is an aspect that is before them, they have asked you to now produce the names.
Can the EC say, look, I'm independent, I'm not going to produce anything. I mean, these are my names. I have custodian of electoral matters. It's got nothing to do with Supreme Court. I'm sorry, but I can't produce it.
Oh, well, happily, they haven't said that. But should that be the case, I think a lot of them are lawyers. Even if they are not, they are very competent lawyers. They are one of the best in town. They know that this matter started as a constitutional matter. And so Article 2 of the Constitution will come into play, where when you read down 345, says that where anybody, pursuant to the hearing of a constitutional or determination of a constitutional matter, fails or in fact refuses to comply with any orders or directive or directions issued by the court, pursuant to that constitutional matter, if he's a president or the vice, he can suffer, it can be a ground for impeachment, removal. If you are the rest of us, at least myself, I call Koshuaba like myself, I can go to jail for at least 10 years. And also, there is an injunction against you even holding some public offices for a number of years after you have served the 10 years or at least less. Okay, so it's not an
easy... It's the same constitution that guarantees the EC that it's autonomous.
You see, it is the problem. That is one problem we have. Look, no institution in Ghana is more independent than the judiciary. But even the judiciary has a regulator. Judicial Council. All right? It has a Judicial Council. The judiciary itself is subject to the court, the decisions of the court. If today the judiciary says a particular judge should be removed, you can't say that I'm independent, so I'm not going. In no public office must be independent of the law. And you are independent when you are within the law. The moment you step out of the law, you are no more you yourself strip yourself of the independence. You cannot be outside the law, and the court declares you are outside the law and still claim that you are independent. You are within the law when you obey the orders of the court. And I made the point, there's a popular case of S. Party Afoda, that even when on the face of it, a court of law has given an erroneous decision, everybody knows this one is wrong because they themselves did not comply with some binding decisions or an act of parliament or constitutional provision and so on. It is not for you They say it's not for the litigant nor his lawyers to sit in their chambers or the closet of their home to decide which decisions of a court should be obeyed because it's right and which one should not be obeyed because it is wrong or it is not capable of being obeyed. If you hold that position, you go to the court. They are humans. They should be able to understand you for further direction, variation, if you are able to justify. But it is not for you to stay in the comfort of your zone and just decide that this one, I disagree with them, so I won't comply with it. I think the consequences are too clear for such persons that likely or hopefully they have made it clear that they are going to comply with the orders of the Supreme Court. These are laws, and you cannot say you won't comply. Hopefully, I think we all happily will witness a compliance by 30th.
Well, this is from Simon Boating Tuasi in the Ashanti region, and this is directly to you. It says, good evening, Nana. Can the electoral commissioner become a flag bearer for a political party? At what point? If no, why? If yes, why? Please let your lawyer help me because I smell something.
Electoral commissioner becoming
a flag bearer of a political party.
Oh, no. I mean, obviously, at that point in time, the person will have to resign before the person can qualify to engage in active party politics, not to even talk about becoming. And then the person becomes a coach and also a referee. And I don't think that is proper. In all sense, it cannot be justified.
It cannot be justified.
Even outside the law.
Can the Supreme Court also look at the practicality, in their judgment, maybe the time I'm giving you may be too short and therefore get a bit more time, or because I'm the Supreme Court, look, I don't care, I've given you the time, whatever it takes, you go and do it? I mean, how does it work? Where does the EC stand? Because the task ahead is too grave and the time is too short.
But fortunately, they are not complaining. Because they themselves, I think about a couple of months ago, according to the court, indicated to them, the first Abu Ramadan hearing, that they have this in their custody. So I even think that the 6 days or 5 days, it was just they were being charitable or gracious. I think they were overly gracious. In actual fact, they could have asked them to produce it the next day. And that should be easy for them to do. They are not complaining. It means they have it. So they will produce it. So no, in any case, if they had complied with these same orders in 2014, 2 years ago, I don't think that we'll be here even pleading for time or extension of time. Fortunately, by the grace of God, they are not complaining. They say they will produce it.
Well, I'm going to take a quick break. When I come back, we'll watch an insert of the Supreme Court's response to the EC, and then we'll continue our conversation. Don't move.
According to the EC's deputy chairperson, the commission's regional heads have already started compiling the names of NHI's registrants as directed by the Supreme Court, adding that they were racing against time to ensure they meet the June 29 deadline.
The apex court of this country has given an order, and the commission, since we operate within the laws of this country, we are not above the law. Okay, so we are doing our work.
Can you meet the deadline?
Well, that is another question. Whatever it is, okay, the Supreme Court has ordered. If you don't meet the deadline, as you are saying, then it's another situation that you got to face. The Supreme Court said by this 29th, let us have the list of all people that you found have used the national health insurance. But I want to assure you, we comply with the laws and the order of the apex court of this country. And we are going to do our best. My officers are ready. As I stand here talking, the director elections called me. And the messages went yesterday. Look at them. Bring the list. We are giving you this time so that we beat the time that the apex court of this country has given the commission.
Amadou Sule highlighted efforts being put in place by the EC to reduce long queues at polling stations during this year's election, especially the expansion in the number of polling stations.
Now we are increasing the number of centers, point, that we're going to vote from about 26,000 to around 29,000. which again we shall furnish you with them. And at this point, we are trying to reduce the number of people who are to come and vote in order to make it very easy to manage the process. The threshold has been fixed to around 950. When I talk about threshold, I'm saying that we would have a center which is more than the 950. And the total centers are going to come around 29,000.
Security of EC officials at the limited registration exercise were of major concern at the conference. This, Mr. Sule says, requires an increase in the number of security officers deployed for the upcoming elections.
There were some areas which we did not consider to be a flashpoint. But if you throw your minds back, during the registration, they erupted. We have about five regions in this country: Greater Accra, Volta, Eastern Ashanti, and Bronga Ahafo. There were some various spots which you heard what happened. There were destructions of our kids. And as security agencies, we take cognizance of anything that we don't expect. You are professionals. We are heading towards the exhibition, which will lead to the cleaning of the voters register, and it will come out with a credible voters register.
Meanwhile, Minister for the Interior, Prosper Bani, once again urged political parties with security concerns to approach the IGP for assistance.
Political parties and their leaders are expected to rely on the only legitimate and approved security organization in the country to provide security at all times, and this organization is the Ghana Police Service.
The police service is confident that systems and structures being put in place will allow for a violence-free election.
Lawyer, well, I don't know. You see, I think the EC may have a genuine case for their posture, their speech, or their pace of work. But maybe it's because of lack of communication. I don't know. What's happening from the EC? Because it's quite frustrating because, they are experienced lawyers, they are experienced people, with 5 months to elections. And experienced people, 5 months to election, should be telling us that, listen, maybe I'm out of ink, or I'm out of paper, or I'm out of resources or something, but calm down. Everybody's just left to speculate.
Mm. Well, I mean, of course, we acknowledge that we are all human and subject to human frailty and all other forms of weaknesses associated with humans, including even recollection and even the appropriate faculty to apply the necessary, if you like, the thought processes to ensure that you bring together the mechanisms to enable you perform such functions. So that is admitted, and we have to grant them that. Mm. But then when, I mean, you, Nana Nomu say, it's the enemy and comprehensor, isn't it? Mm. Yeah. So when it becomes persistent, as if a matter that almost everybody understands and accepts, it appears to be ambiguous to you, then it becomes a problem. So yes, we admit that they are humans, but I think that, and I ask the question, so what injury will be caused the EC if they just comply with this simple directive? If anybody who used the NHI card also feels that he's been disenfranchised and there's no way that his right to vote, which is for me the most important secret right, maybe with the exception of right to life, that the person has, then the person has a recourse. Leave that to the people, and not that you just insist that in spite of these clear provisions, this is your stance. And I'm saying that it also is born out of some of this perception about the EC being independent and autonomous. No state institution funded by the people of Ghana can pretend to be more superior than the people themselves. The sovereign will of the people is over and above everybody in this country, so that you don't pretend that you are more powerful than the law itself or those who vested you with just a small portion of their sovereignty. So when that is recognized, I think that in a situation like this...
Look, are we also jumping the gun? Because the EC said, sometime in July, they're going to open this register for everybody to come and check. Clearly, those who are dead will not be able to come and check. Mm. And those who are foreigners, may not be able to come and check. I don't know. I mean, are we rushing ahead of them?
Well, no, not exactly. But it's also because of mistrust. I think that almost everybody is looking over their shoulders when it comes to elections. And that is why I started by saying that if we don't change our attitude and we don't apply our conscience, it doesn't matter what orders even the Supreme Court may give. Anytime a decision like this will be given, people will fashion out other things to counter it. So as a people, the bottom line is that why can't we do what others do? Remove all forms of suspicion. It is these same Ghanaians who will go and lift ballot boxes, and so there's a need for people to be around. These same Ghanaians who will bring minors, who encourage non-citizens to come and register. If we decide not to do this, engage in this criminal act anymore and misconduct, there will be no need for even the Supreme Court coming to sit together to make such orders. There will be no need of burdening the EC in this way. We are in this situation because we have, most of us have decided just not to do the right thing when it comes to elections.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, lawyer Yao Opon, private legal practitioner, and also lecturer at Central University. Let me just say again that lawyer Maliba was supposed to be here. He needed, sent a message, he said he was going to come, but maybe something came about and he could not make it. So that's why he wasn't here. But tomorrow, IEA interacts with the CPP. Mr. Greenstreet would have an encounter with the IEA, tell us his plans and interact with guests. And we will be here to analyze his speech, his body language and everything, just like we did the PNC. But let me say thank you very much to Tantiz, who gives me my shirts for the show. And Tantiz is on 024-366-2001. 024-366-2001. There's a 10% going. Give them a call and get your nice 10%. But lawyers promised me to give me a new cover, which my wife always hates it, that why do you come on TV with this cover? But lawyers promised to give me a cover. Thank you very much for watching. We'll be here another day. Thank you very much in advance.